So the last speaker of this morning is Wolfgang Gatterbauer from Carnegie Mellon University. He will talk about approximate lifted inference with probability.
Thank you. Well, thank you for coming. So this talk picks very much up from the tutorial that Dan gave before. The question we want to ask here, we have now seen a couple of instances when inference can be performed in efficient time. What do we do with the hard cases? And can we use some of those tricks in an approximate way to also solve those cases approximately? So perhaps with more motivation. So we saw, and Stuart gave this good motivation yesterday, that somehow many people believe that there's a sweet spot between combining of first order logic and probabilities, because we want to combine these two words. First order allows us to express, for example, constraints, soft constraints, like Dan has said, also queries that we want to express, and probabilities take care for all this uncertainty. And the community has a bunch of different proposals of how this is be done, and there's still involvement. Questions like Stuart argued yesterday well for the open world assumptions, some other approaches use the closed world assumption, but this is kind of the assumption. We somehow express what we want, constraints, queries, in a first order logic that somehow combines these probabilities. Now, the hard step that most of these approaches use is then we need to ground this. We take this expression, we then have to ground it, create a variable interaction graph, and then perform inference over this graph. Inference is hard, and therefore many different approaches use sampling. We've heard many approaches today, also even yesterday, MCMQ sampling. So at the same time we have seen this morning, both the Dan Sutcher and Dan Alterno, there are certain results that for certain types of problems, based on the structures, we can solve them efficiently. And if we can solve them efficiently, also often called liftable, then things become super fast. We don't need to perform sampling. We can perform everything very efficiently, for example, in databases, by slightly manipulating the operators. And the problem we're trying to solve here, look at, can we somehow use these ideas that we have here, but also extend them to the hard cases? So we want to perform approximate lifted inference. And what do we need mean with lifted inference? So different people have mentioned different things, like Frank yesterday also mentioned lifted. So what do we, when we talk about approximate lifted inference, what do we mean with this? So the community has defined, for example, also Guy in the back here, is what is lifted inference? Well, if you somehow can exploit certain symmetries in the problem, in the relational structure of the model. Now, what we are interested in is we want to express a certain algebraic, we want to calculate the value of a certain algebraic expression, we want to calculate the probability of something. So this is like, it boils down, we're going to see later on, certain expressions. So what does this mean to have a symmetry? So if you look at this, for example, xf plus xg, then this is symmetric in f and g. So you can also factorize this. So when we talk here about the way we interpret symmetries is more or less, well, there's a certain structure in the problem that allows you to efficiently factorize this expression. So this means when we talk about approximate lifted inference, what we mean is like, well, find some approximate ways to factorize expressions. The way you find these approximations, this is guided by the relational structure so that you can always evaluate it efficiently in polynomial time. So this is what we mean with approximate lifted inference. Okay, so we process in two different steps. First, we're going to look at Boolean functions. And Bart has talked about Boolean functions. This underlies many of the things that we're going to do, and then see how we can apply certain ideas to the first order setting. So Boolean functions. So why Boolean functions? It turns out graphical models, model counting, probability databases, all of these can be reduced in a certain way to evaluate the probability of a Boolean function. So if we can solve this problem, as Mr. Bart mentions, if we can solve and understand this, what is hard about this, then we can use this as a basic building block to also solve these problems. Yeah. And the way we're going to do this here is just to illustrate the tricks that we're going to use, we're going to see this with the help of network reliability. The only reason why, because it's very easy to follow what we're going to do. And then in the second part, we're going to use this kind of tricks, simplifications, for which we shaped the intuition in the first part, for network reliability, we then apply this to the setting of probability databases. Okay, so network reliability. So what is this? So you have source target. You have the question was a bipartite, so a multiparted graph, a four-parted graph. You have source, a target. You have different nodes in between. These nodes have assumed an independent probability, so they can be true or false independently. And I want to calculate the probability that S and T are connected. So S and T are connected, yeah, the function is true if they're connected, and they're connected if, well, if either of four paths is true. Yeah. So if this path, if you look at the first path, well, the first path is true, the first path is true if, well, if we have x1 and y1. Yeah. So this is the first path and the second path and so on. So we have three different paths. The problem now comes, the problem of this particular case is that those paths are not independent. And we heard the notion of independence is an essential part. If they were independent, this is easy. But they're not independent. And that's the reason why what one needs to use is Shannon expansion. So yeah, then,
parts,
please.
Right?
So this is directed, so there are only three paths.
Only what?
So we assume a directed graph. So then the number of paths we have from here to here, so we cannot go here back and make cycles or something.
No, but in general, you can have a graph can have exponentially many paths, right?
Right.
So you get an exponential larger expression.
So if you have a four-parted graph, so it means what you're saying is the formula. If you have an arbitrary graph that becomes longer and longer and longer, and it becomes exponential in the number of partites that we have. If you bear with me for a moment and we assume that we have now a four-parted graph, this means what we have in general is we have a four-parted graph. This means we have now here m different nodes and here n different nodes. Then the exponent that you refer to is only exponential in the number of different parts that we have. But if you only fix now four-parted, then we don't have exponential many paths. Because we have more or less the Cartesian product. It boils down to the Cartesian product between m and n.
Yeah, Cartesian product usually give exponential explosion, right?
Exponential if you allow to now have 1 and 2, so m and n. But if you now say, oh, times n, times n, times n.
You assume a bounded number of components?
For this example, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So this means the result is more or less, even if it's bounded, it already becomes hard. And later in the talk, at least in the backup, I have something. If you go back to this, what if you don't do this? It was bound to the notion of your notion of data query complexity, and yeah, okay. But again, I can also respond to the questions before.
A blank check. I'm going to put it on my web page.
Well, we do it very often on our slides because we refer you off. Okay, but so for the case of this one, what you now do is now we want to study the hard cases, and even if things are bounded in the depth of the partites. It's already hard, and why, I'm come back to it in a second, yeah? But let's now stay with this, because here we want to shape some intuition about what is done. So what is done? This is something that Dan mentioned in his tutorial, the Shannon expansion. Whenever we have these variables, we want to express this, we want to calculate this formula, we need to do these different types from our toolbox. One of those is Shannon expansion. What it is, well, we pick one of those variables that is has shared paths, yeah? And then we say, well, what is, if this is true or false, total probability theorem, they're separate, we can add them up. Well, if this is true, right, if this is true, then we only need that either this or this is here. Yeah? Either of this here, if it's false, then we need this path, and then it's that. Yeah? So this means we can, for this example, we can write an expression, and this expression calculates us the probability as a function of the input probabilities. And there's just one thing is, this is here the independent OR. So we use this because this shows nicely the duality between disjunction and conjunction. Things become far concise. Yeah? So for the purpose of this, this here just says 1 minus times 1 minus and so on. So, and even if we have now this bounded, this means even if we have now here just a four-parted graph and we make this here longer and longer, calculating this already becomes hard. Although the number today with lineage, the Boolean formula, the size of this DNF is bounded, m times n maximum. So, okay. So, what is the idea? So, the idea is the formula is we are going to cheat, we are going to change the problem into a simpler problem, and then we're asking what is the maximal thing we can change in order to get best upper or lower bounds on the original problem. So what are we?
I'm missing something here.
Okay.
A network reliability has an F PIRAS, right?
So, okay.
Network reliability has F PIRAS.
Okay.
So I'm trying to understand what is he trying to say here.
So what he's saying is that, you can make a randomized approximation, right?
Randomized approximation with epsilon, you know, it's a kind of epsilon delta model, right?
Okay, yeah. We're now trying to find a deterministic approximation. So any kind of Markov chain, any kind of sampling procedure gives you some kind of guarantees on the outcome. It gives you randomized guarantees, but what you need to do is you need to have some model that includes sampling because you need a randomized procedure. What we're trying to do on a high level is can we find some deterministic procedure so we can exploit existing algebraic methods like query plans. So we don't need to include sampling in all of these methods. Yeah? So we try to find some approximations, upper and lower bounds, that don't use any kind of sampling, but give us upper or lower bounds. Okay. So we're going to do this as the following is, we're going now to change this problem here. We have a problem that's easy, and then think how we can compensate for what we did there over here. So imagine now we changed this network. We changed the network so that those paths became independent. Yeah? So we split up this node into two different nodes. So this one's, the resulting expression here then looks like this. Notice now that we have here two different variables, and because we have two different variables, this expression actually can be factorized, and we have something that's called a read-once formula. This is also something that was mentioned by Dan Altea today. So whenever we have this, the problem becomes easy. And you can see the structure here. It should intuitively a serial parallel graph. What is this? So if you look at the graph, you can look that the upper part is independent from the lower part. So in the expression, we have here a big independent OR between those ones. The first one is, you just multiply them. Here multiplies an independent of this one with this one. So this kind of expression just represents the serial parallel nature of this particular graph. Yeah. So and our question is now, if we now change this problem with that problem, what are the appropriate probabilities we want to assign those originally same variables so to get guaranteed upper lower bounds? So, and let's do this first by staying in the models. So Guy is going to talk about model counting. And the models is something that's the baseline for what you can do with approximation and deterministic sense. So the models. So what is this model? So here we have a Karnaugh map. Here we have this DNF. A Karnaugh map just shows that what are all those different models for which this one is here true, this formula is here true. And these are the models that we have here, yeah? These eight models. So notice that this is a monotone Boolean function. So this picture here, and I see I forgot here some negative, but this picture shows us the formulas. Let's look at the all 2 to the power of 4 possible truth assignments to the variables. And I see that something is here wrong because one of those here should be a negative. So let me change this here. So this is here should probably be negative, and this also negative, yeah? So what does this mean? So let's look at any kind of model. This here, what this means is, oh, y1 is false, x2 is true, x1 is false, and y2 is, no, I think what I did was wrong. Should not have done this. I got confused, so let me erase this again.
Those are assignments to x1, x2, and the columns
correct.
Are assignments to y1, y2?
So it combines 4 dimensions into a 2-dimensional representation. So what it says is like this, so whenever it's inside of columns for which you see the parentheses, it's this variable is true. So for example, these two columns here, y2 is true. For these two columns, y2 is false. Yeah. And this just shows us the different truth assignments for which this is true. So if we now want to find with any kind of approximation algorithm, even mini-bucket, what Bart said before. So what it turns out what these approximation methods do, they do something like this. So we know the formula is whenever we have, now here, split these variables, I can always assign one of those variables the value 0 or 1. And if I do this, then I'm still in the same space of the original models because we still have 4 different variables. Yeah. So given this monotone function, and 1 is bigger or equal to the original probability, we know we are guaranteed to get an upper bound. So here, for example, if you replace x1 prime with 1, yeah, this implies this. We can ignore this. And our upper bound looks like this. Yeah? There's an upper bound. And similarly, if you place it at 0, we get a lower bound. Lower bound because you see that the models here are subset of this, and here's a superset. Yeah? So we get upper or lower bounds if you stay in the same models. And the question is now the formula is, can we do better? Yeah, so can we do better than this approximation? So this means if you look at the space of possible values that we assign to these two dissociated variables, we can give them any value between 0 and 1. And from what I've shown you before, is intuitively, if we give one of them, or both 1, we get guaranteed upper bounds. And if we give them 0, we get guaranteed lower bounds. But the question is, can we do anything better if we look at this whole space? Importantly, this space is not anymore a model-based bound, because now we have more variables. We have now 5 variables instead of 4 variables. So it turns out the way the world looks like is like this. So whenever you assign them the same probability or bigger to each of the ones, you get a guaranteed upper bound. If you assign them to a value so that you have the independent or being smaller than the original, you get a guaranteed lower bound. So let me illustrate this with an example also that shows an example of model counting. So let's use this example and assume that all of the probabilities are 0.5. So then you can just say, well, 0.5, you calculate this expression. And if you now look at the space, yeah, the space of the possible bounds, then you see that it turns out the true value for this is 0.5. The upper bounds that models can give you are 0.63, 0.69. Lower bounds 0.38 and 0.44. But the best upper bound that this dissociation can give you is 0.53. And it's considerably better than the model-based bounds. So, and this can also be used for model counting. So in model counting, you just say, well, you now just multiply this with the possible number of models, so 2^4, and now you get bounds for models. Yeah? So the lower bounds for models, if you used model-based approximations, is either 6 or 7, upper 10 or 11. This bound here gives you 8.5. Because 8.5 is not an integer, you need to round up, so 8. So you get the exact value, actually. So what I want to show this is that this kind of upper bound, this asymmetry, is very interesting, and it gives you very, very good approximations. And you can't recover these approximations if you stay just in the realm of models. And very interesting, because Mark mentioned this, I've recorded some presentation, I will put this online a couple of days, is we have shown that actually this can also improve mini-bucket. So you take mini-bucket, you take any kind of model-based approximation, you plug this in, and you get better bounds. So why now this? So, well, it turns out what I've shown you here was just a DNF expression, a disjunctive dissociation. What I mean is like you have a function which consists of a disjunction of two functions which contain the same variable. You split now these two variables, assign a new values, and you get a guaranteed upper lower bounds. The dual holds if you do the same stuff for conjunctions. And then you get the nice bound for the lower bound, not for the upper bound.
What can you say about the quality of the bounds that you're getting?
Nothing. You cannot give any guarantees.
You cannot provably give any guarantees if you don't have theorems anymore.
So we have no guarantees. So we have no guarantees. And also I can construct an example. I see. So there's two answers to this one. Yeah? So what we are trying to do here is the formulas. We are trying to give oblivious bounds. What does this mean? So this means that assume you have a very complicated expression. This is really complicated. There's many sub-expressions in these ones. We want to find some method that gives us a guaranteed polynomial time to evaluate it. So we have guaranteed polynomial time, you can evaluate it, but this means it comes in the effect of approximations. If now one was able to evaluate the probability of these functions, one could probably give some kind of bounds. But if you just say, hey, I have an expression, I have here something, I have something like this, and I don't know what's in this one, yeah, then you cannot do better. And then you also, the bounds, I can construct examples where the bounds would be really, really worse, really bad off. So it's a little simple to the example that we've seen before in the previous talk. If we use the parity function, then things become complicated. So you can also construct some examples, unrealistic natural examples, in which the bounds are arbitrarily off. Yeah. So this means if you stay in this realm, we can give the best bounds that are possible if you use the perspective that you don't look at the sub-expressions. The interesting thing is that if you just look now at the model-based bounds, and there's different approaches that do model-based bounds, for example, even mini-buckets, then the upper bounds that these model-based bounds give you can always be improved. So you use some existing method that applies mini-bucket in certain variable order. Instead of using at the min or the max that mini-bucket does, you just plug this in and you get guaranteed better bounds for the upper bounds. For the lower bounds, well, you get just more. You get infinite many bounds, but they are in the same realm and they're not as good. Yeah? So this means, and there's also something which relates to your question is, there's a framework from Troy and Davish, relax and compensate, but this is, well, what is the exact value to get the correct expression? The issue here is that this applies, this is correct exactly if you only have one shared variable and if you can evaluate these expressions efficiently. Yeah. In general, you cannot evaluate this, and if you have many, many different variables to dissociate, you cannot give guaranteed upper or lower bounds. So it means what I want you to take away here from this part is that this is a method that allows us to upper and lower bound Boolean functions. And for the case of DNFs, which is relevant for network reliability, also we're going to see for a certain type of queries in probability databases, the upper bounds are really nice.
Yeah. What does walk very well mean?
That in our experiments that I'm going to show you, it beats, for example, Monte Carlo simulations in quality and time. So we have no guarantees of how close these bounds work, but in practice, they work very well. And the intuition for this is that we cannot say how well they work, but you give me any model-based bound, upper bound for DNFs, I can give you a better bound with this method. I cannot do the same with the lower bound. Okay, so how do we use, how do we apply this for probabilistic databases? So the next slide is a quick repetition of some of the parts that Ben has shown. So what is a conjunctive query in a database? You have here, for example, a SQL instruction, a SQL query that requires exactly the same thing as data log. And we love to use data log because all the information that we have here in this SQL query and the schema is here concisely described in this particular data log query. So, and we see in particular these joins, the joins of the variables. So what does a database do? Well, we have here an instance of three different relations. It now tries to find here the possible joins between those different tables, and then gives you out, well, give me all the sets, all the possible values here, E and F, and it duplicates. Yeah? So back semantics. It duplicates this. So this is what databases normally do. And so here, so Marsh said that he wants to have some couple. It's like this kind of thing is, if we fix our query, yeah, we fix the query, and we now make this database bigger and bigger. So, for example, we have a query that says, who takes a class or who is friend with somebody, and now you make the social network bigger and bigger to Facebook kind of size, then you can evaluate this all sufficiently. This is the high-level idea. So probabilistic databases now say, what happens if you don't know the certainty of these tuples, because you simply extract them from the web? You now get here all the probabilities for the answers, and the goal is here now. The promise is you can rank them. Think about Google. In Google, you have a gigantic big knowledge base, uncertain knowledge base, inconsistent, the web. You issue a query. It gives you now 100,000 of results, but you hope that the first 10 are the best you get. That's what we care about, the ranking of these ones. And the top ones are really good. And this is here now hard for the reasons explained before, that even if you just fix these queries, this is here hard. That's all I want to say on the background. One more thing. This particular here focuses on the set of self-joint free contractive queries that also Ben Altiano mentioned, also non-repeating ones. So this means if you have in the dialogue expression here all different symbols, and what we're going to use, because everything we're going to see becomes very concise and easy to understand, is we're using something that's atypical in databases to describe queries, but you see it becomes everything super simple. So this is the incidence metric. What this shows is here you show vertically all the different tables, the relations, and you show the different variables they share. The nice thing about this is you can very efficiently reason about this query. You see, oh, who shares X's, where does Y appear? So you can reason in terms of characteristics that you need for what's coming in a couple of slides from now. Yeah. So that's the only thing that we do here differently from things we've done before. OK, so let's look first at an easy query, the relation to Boolean formulas, then a hard query, and see if we can somehow incorporate these ideas from the easy query to the hard query. So this here turns out is an easy query, according to this theorem that Dan mentioned earlier. What means easy? So notice the formulas. If you now look at this particular graph here, then when is this query true? So this query is true if either this here, or this here is true. So this means we get back our provenance, lineage, our Boolean function. Yeah. So this means if we can evaluate the Boolean function, we can also evaluate the probability of this particular query. And now it turns out that this particular query can be factorized efficiently because of the structure. So we can take this Boolean formula, we factorize it, so we get a read once formula, and this is easy. And exactly this is what Dan mentioned at the beginning, is whether this is easy or not is something that we see in the structure of the query. Yeah? And if this is possible, then we can evaluate this with these kind of plans. And these plans exactly correspond to the factorization of how you take these different variables and combine them with independent ORs and independent ENDs. So here's an example of the hard query. This hard query was used also in the talks by both Dan's, Dan Altiano and Dan Sutro. So this is an example query that is hard. And here's now the interesting decision why it's hard. The same reason why the example from network availability was hard. If you look at this, how this graph here now, the instance, so if you ground it, so you have this query here, now you see you ground this, the graph. Yeah? In this case, it's a graph. Generally, it's more a hypergraph. How these different variables interact, that you see actually that R1 appears twice and T7 appears twice. And there's no way that we can factorize this now efficiently to have our nice read once formulas. And this is hard. And this condition that also the two Dan's mentioned about hierarchy can be very easily seen here in this incidence matrix. So what is it? So if you now look at this, is notice the formulas, that all the different relations in which Y appear are subsets of the ones in which X appears. That makes it easy because you can factorize something out, you can multiply something, and this factorization corresponds exactly to the structure of this query. In this here, we cannot do this because, yeah, there is no such subset. So that's the syntactic condition of whether a query is hard or easy. Okay, so now we're going to do the formulas. Now we're trying to apply this idea of cheating at the first order level. So what are we going to do? So notice the formulas, that what would we have to do at the first order level to change this formula into something that is like this, where T7 and T8 are different? Because if they're different, we could factorize it and we can evaluate it. And then we can use all this upper and lower bounds we've just seen in a couple of slides before. So we can do the formulas. We can now change both the data instance and the query. If you now bear with me and we change the query so that we change this ty into tx and y, we are back to this query here. What we need to do for this is we need to also change the data instance. The reason is C here joins with AC and DC, so we need to get two different tuples. Two tuples, one is AC and DC, so that the expression that we have here is not exactly the same, except now we have here a different tuple, right? And this change that we do here, both at the query level and the data level. You can think as this visual metaphor, a simple intuitive visual representation of what we're going to do. Yeah? So we're just noticing here this dark point here to say, oh, we change here, we dissociate x. We add here x to the table here and make the appropriate changes in the table. So we change it in the query and the table. And then what we have is, because now what we have is here, we are back at our hierarchy. If we have this expression here, we can actually evaluate this with the same plan that we could evaluate the one from before. And the interesting thing is now, that's not the only way. We can also do something in a different way. Yeah? We can also now change our table, and we change this in a different way. And this also becomes a query, which has a different plan, but it can also be evaluated in polynomial time. So this means, let me make this more general. So assume we have now a more complicated query here, and this here just represents this query in this incidence matrix. So now we can look at all the possible ways we can dissociate the tables. 2 to the power of 3, because there's 3 ways to put this dark dot into this one. Yeah? So we can look at this partial dissociation order. What is the idea? Well, let's look at all the possible ways, all the exponential in the size of the query ways to do this. And keep in mind that, well, the partial order is anything is high up if it contains a superset of the variables from before. So now what we know is if we apply this dissociation and use the same probabilities that the individual tuples had from before, then we are guaranteed to get upper bounds because all of these are DNFs. And this dissociation, dissociation here does nothing else than just dissociate this and treat them as independent. So if you change now the formula to this and keep and give them the same probabilities, then we're guaranteed to get upper bounds. Now, the second thing is, notice that some of those ones, shown here by green, some of the dissociations fulfill this syntactic criterion of a hierarchy. So we know that these here, they're all easy to evaluate. We have ways to evaluate them efficiently. And what we can define is, well, a good approximation, good not exactly specified in any kind of condition, but a reasonable approximation is to say, hey, evaluate all the possible upper bounds that you can evaluate efficiently and take the minimum, and it's still guaranteed to be an upper bound. So the second thing is now notice the formula is that it turns out that each of those possible dissociations which correspond to hierarchies, they have plans. So you can evaluate those plans, actually it turns out, without changing the data instance. I've shown you that we change this data instance, you don't even need to do this because this plan, these plans take care of this assumption of independence. So, and then also notice that this dissociation order, this partial order that we have here, also carries over naturally to these different plans. So what we know, instead of now evaluating all of those 5 different plans, it's just enough to evaluate these 2 plans. Because these 2 plans are the minimum in this partial order. We always know we can evaluate this, but we know we get a lower bound with this plan here, so we don't even need to do this. Yeah? So this means the idea is now, we take a query, and you just look for all these minimal plans to get an upper bound on the original query. The nice thing is, it's a generalization. If the query is easy in p-time, then that's you're done. Yeah? So this means this is some way that allows us to upper, and you can also change this to lower bound, but the lower bound's not as good. If you're curious, I can show you some examples in the backup of how good upper and lower bounds work. But the upper bounds should work really well. We do this for any self-joint free. This is like the non-repeating case queries. And we can do this then with any existing relational database. OK, so this is the idea. So let's look at some experiments. How much time? I have 5 minutes. Okay, so experiments. What are we going to do? What are the questions we're trying to answer? And what are the tools we're going to use? So we use this. We compare dissociation against Monte Carlo simulations, random sampling, exact probabilistic inference. This was a question that came up. I think Dana asked this question. what has this to do with this solvers? It turns out what we're using for this a certain tool that was developed by Gogan and Dechter. This tool calculates exactly the partition function of a Markov random field, and we just repurpose this tool for our goal. You just use our DNFs, you transform them into one minus the CNFs by changing something of the variables, and you can use then this tool to evaluate the ground truth of this DNF. The nice thing is this tool here has won some competitions. There's some competitions, I don't remember which it was, but at the time it was one of the state-of-the-art tools. So this gives us then the ground truth whenever we can get it. It also gives us an understanding of how hard this problem is if you want to solve it in exactly. Because
why people would you use Monte Carlo? You can just here use a simple rejection sampling. I don't see why you need here Monte Carlo, right? I mean, this makes no sense to me.
So not for me.
It's a DNF with bounded cubes. And that means that every term contributes a linear fraction from the solution space. So rejection sampling should work well here.
To be honest, I'm unfamiliar with rejection sampling. So it's rejection sampling, it would speed up, or would it give you a better... So if you sample now 10 times rejection sampling, would you have to have fewer samples needed to get the same accuracy, or would you get a better accuracy with the same number of samples? So if you compare now rejection sampling against Monte Carlo, and let's do 10 times rejection sampling as compared to 10 times Monte Carlo, does it give you a better bound, or is it faster?
Well, rejection sampling is the way to go here.
What does Monte Carlo mean here? Is it not just sampling and counting? Is it not just rejection sampling?
Monte Carlo here means...
You could do important sampling, but I don't see why...
So the thing is, I don't know what important sampling is, but let me show you what we do. So what... Yeah, I don't know what rejection sampling is, so therefore I ask, if you compare it to what we do, is it faster or is it better? So what we do is we take this lineage, this provenance, and then we say, okay, we now sample randomly each of those different variables, say, is it true or false? Then we repeat this 10, 50, 100, 1,000 times and get the average value of this. So that's what we do in our Monte Carlo simulations.
That's what you call Monte Carlo?
Right. So therefore, to understand better, if you now use rejection sampling, would it be faster or better if you have to...
Rejection sampling.
This is a rejection. Yeah, it's a rejection sampling because you just count how many times you hit a one.
Okay. So it seems we have done rejection sampling without me knowing that this is the term that is used. Okay.
The thing that works well here is important sampling. That's what you mean.
Yeah, important sampling would work much better. Yeah.
And to understand, would it require you to have fewer iterations? Or would it give you the same number of iterations, better quality?
Fewer number of iterations.
I see. Okay. So that is good to know. So what we have used is here, we have used this simple method of sampling. Except for this inference, and this is also interesting. So very often people ask, why do you need probabilities? So is there any kind of 3 minutes? Is there any kind of method that we can think of that doesn't use probabilities? What we are interested in here is the following. We want to measure the quality of the answers. What is this? The quality is the ranking. So we assume that I give you a query, you know an oracle that gives you the correct ranking of the answers, and we want to know how good are different methods at providing you the same kind of ranking. What you want to have a very good ranking, think about like Google. The individual scores does not matter. It matters that you get the ranking correct. And average precision is a certain metric that is very often used from information retrieval that gives you the quality of the ranking as compared to a ground truth. So that means what we're going to do is we look at certain instances where we can get the ground truth, and then we evaluate different methods, how close are they in the rankings to the ground truth. And one baseline is here is what happens if you don't use probabilities? We just ask for all the different tuples that we get, how big is the lineage? By ignoring the probabilities. So it's like a very naive way to think, if you don't keep track of probabilities, we just count how many pages, for example, link to a certain page, and this is then the page rank, irrespective of how trustworthy it is. It is Stanford, it is some spam page. Yeah? It's like a naive way to say, hey, how well does it work? And then we ask about efficiency. So we've done this over the TPCH database. Let me skip now the assumptions. I can go over this and just show the results. So results in time and ranking quality. Time. the baseline is, so what is this, the axis? So here, we used different queries, parameterized queries, that allow us to say, how big is the DNF, how big is the lineage, how big is the provenance, and then say, how well do different methods scale, if you now make the size of the problem bigger and therefore more complicated. So standard SQL just gives you the answer without any rankings. So the biggest one, PostgreSQL needs 2 seconds to just give you the answers without any kind of guarantees. PostgreSQL needed six seconds to give you the lineage. This means the DNF formula. Any kind of method that uses the formula and then uses any kind of sampling or any kind of outside tool needs to have this DNF and then perform inference on top of this. The certain methods also...
How did you assign the probabilities? Because it's sensitive to...
Right. So we added here a random probability for between 0 and 1, like a uniform distribution.
So for each tuple, you pick a value p which is uniform between 0 and 1.
Correct.
And that's the probability for that tuple.
Correct.
Right. So, and you do this independently for every tuple?
Correct.
Or you use the same value for
every tuple? No, different ones. Different ones.
Why?
So independent, we assign a different probability. So one can be 0.3, 0.5, 0.8. When you said...
Why can't everything be 0.3?
So it turns out if you do everything 0.5, if you do this, and it's a good thing, then it turns out that that even ranking by lineage works quite well, it turns out. Yeah. So it turns out if we have, then it's we don't even need probabilities in a certain sense. It's not exactly right what I say, but it turns out if we use this, then even with ranking by the size of your evidence, because each of them has the same probability, is the same. So therefore, we use something randomly, yeah? Because this is the assumption here. And you compare different methods also in the quality here. So this is here exact inference. It's exponential, not surprising. This is Monte Carlo, the way we call Monte Carlo, this independent sampling of these different variables, with 1,000 times. 10,000 times will take 10 times times. If you use some other method I'm not familiar with, maybe it's faster. Yeah, it's faster. And this is now how long our method takes. Notice you have different curves, 5 different curves. What I didn't say is that we actually have 5 different methods to speed up the evaluation, which takes into account, for example, functional dependencies, deterministic relations. So to not evaluate each of the planes independently, but to reuse calculations. And depending on the area of the query, certain optimizations bring you something. Sometimes they do not. Yeah. It's like in databases. So but even like the normal database here has certain functions because the optimizer is clever and has learned over 20 years how to deal with a certain problem. Here we just show what is the different methods, optimizations, and this is the time. So notice here, instead of 6 seconds, you need 11 seconds. And interesting, the quality we get, ranking by lineage size, already gets you something. If you have all the same, it turns out, I don't remember the value, but it was like 0.85 or 0.9. Because then you don't take into account that something is 0.1 and something is 0.95. Yeah? Monte Carlo, not surprisingly, gets better the often you sample, and this approximation works considerably better for this particular assumption that we used here, yeah, on this example. So let me some thought on this though. What we're doing here is very often. I need to the last slide here. So we are, what many of people were looking here is approximate inference. Yeah, we have some models. Probabilistic models, probabilistic graphical models. These are hard to evaluate, so we're trying to find approximate ways to do this. Very often, these models are actually learned from the real data. And we assume that these probabilities are learned from some kind of real assumption, and then we evaluate our model in some ways. So now, given that this is hard, would it not make sense to not learn hard models? Can we find some other models which are easy? The models of the presentation, it's very unlikely that our brain evaluates sharply hard problems. Yeah? So, and also there's like work that says very often if we use the same approximation methods that we use for inference, also for learning, we get a better end-to-end performance. So, and the good thing about this allows, if you have a certain prediction, a ranking, for example, like many of you on Google click on the second highest rated item, not the first one. Well, Google knows it needs to update its probability somehow, flip something, and this can be done efficiently with this as well. OK, good. So I thank you for your attention. And sorry if I'm a little bit over time.
Maybe we have time for one quick question. People are too
unprepared. Yeah. So essentially generate large positive DNFs, right? So, but then I imagine that you can easily get probabilities close to one, even if you do your approximation there, right? So you don't have to really try very hard to find an approximation for these very large formulas, right? Did that play any role in your experimental setup? Did you realize that probabilities were very close?
So what you're saying is, so what you're saying, and I think this is also very related to what Bart said. Bart said, and we're not sure why it didn't work, but he said that it were problems that are very close or hard or they were unlikely. If you want the color simulations and you simulate something that is very close to one or very close to zero, then you need to sample very often to see a difference between the different items. So this means what you're saying is, Stefan, is on one hand you can say if you're close to one, you just give all of the results to the user, yeah? If you have something that's 0.95, 0.96, 0.98, you don't care what the difference is. Is that what you said? Because all of them are very close to one or very close to zero, so you, it doesn't matter how to rank these ones. So this is something that is true. Monte Carlo, what we call Monte Carlo simulations, does not perform well if you're close to one or if you're close to zeros, yeah? But this method does not, because the rankings, the approximation does not.
But your method or any other simple method would actually perform way better. Right. I mean, I can come up with a very simple method that would work for such cases very, very well.
For the ranking?
Yeah.
How for the ranking?
I'm sorry to
Because notice, it's the ranking here. It is not the value itself.
Two-person conversation. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
So we reconvene at 2:00. There should be a link.